Screen is visible, right?
Yes, yes.
Okay, so we will quickly start, I think, chat window. Okay, fine. Yeah, so we will quickly start with today's session. Today's session, as already mentioned, we will be discussing on the business plan. So basically, I already gave an overview in my last session as to what exactly would be a business plan. But today we'll deep dive into each and every head of business plan. Now, what happens? What do you feel is the significance of a business plan for an entrepreneur? In your view, why is, you can unmute yourself and speak, okay? So why do you feel that a business plan is required for any entrepreneur?
Yeah, for when you talk about plan, we can say what is the vision and mission statement, who are the target audience, and what is the cash flow, we have to make the budget to do the thing. So all that is called, actually, we can call it actually business plan.
Right.
I think Vijay is joining now from
other. He's now joined in from Growth Launcher ID. Yeah. Triveni, what are your thoughts on this?
Jyoti, I'm driving, so I can't unmute myself often. I'm able to hear you, Jyoti. Sorry about this.
Okay. No worries. All right. So, yes, I mean, see, generally 80 to 90% of the startups business fail in the initial 3 to 5 years. We've seen that across the globe simply because, you know, there could be many reasons. There could be not enough funding. There could be things like not getting the right kind of prototype, not getting the right kind of business customers, not analyzing your business properly. All of this starts with the initial stage. In our last session, we discussed about vision, mission. Before that, we talked about the unique idea. Okay, fine. We all have unique ideas. We can think across and we can get different ideas. We may also be capable of, you know, structuring a vision, mission statement. But what happens is we cannot see long term. And this business plan is one such tool which helps us to, first of all, bring about the concept of planning in our business. And secondly, helps us to see the longer term vision. Many a times it is, you know, when you're writing a business plan, you have to think. It calls for creative thinking. It calls for thinking on each and every aspect, each and every role of your business. So first, let us understand what is a business plan. So a business plan, obviously, we discussed these components in our last session. It will have all of these components. But in the first place, we should also understand that in spite of having these components, imagine you sitting down and identifying your market, identifying your product, competitors, whatever all is there. So all of this, when you sit to write down in a form of a structured plan, the challenges will come forward. The challenges as an entrepreneur we will face, okay, today my product description is like that. Where do I want to go 5 years from now? You know, if I'm talking about description of the product, you describe your product. You might want to diversify your product or service. You might want to diversify. You might want to increase the basket of product and services. What are you going to do in the first year, second year, third year, 5 years, 10 years, and so on? So it helps you in the planning process. It helps you in that goal setting for your business. So this is the reason why business plan at the initial stage is very important. All of us must keep in mind that, you know, there is no such thing like a perfect business plan. We can try to put in everything and make it perfect, but it will call for changes. Because once you sit to review, na, a lot of things will come in and there will be additions and deletions as you go on. So first step we are going to cover today is business plan. This calls for review every quarterly by a business owner. I would suggest every quarterly simply because you may see that, you know, market analysis might change, customer tastes and preferences might change. You are not able to foresee many things at the initial stage. If you're able to foresee and it works fine, yeah, only a review mechanism can just help you say, okay, it's perfectly all right, I'm moving on to the next. But if it is not so, then what? Then you have to actually revisit each and every point. So quarter is like a, you know, a decent time frame that you should revisit your business plan. And that is why setting it in detail with crisp papers, documentation is very important. And that is why business plan comes at the initial stage. So let's look at why we should have a business plan. What all I was talking, because once you start working on your idea or your project, it will provide you a clarity how you're going to execute it. You know, the how and whys of execution, what research is required, what will be my business model, how will I get the desired results of what I have thought I want to do? What team do I need? What are the people in the team will I need? How many leaders do I need? Am I capable of handling roles? What roles am I capable of handling? And yes, investors are interested in the business plan. They just see the executive summary. That's the first part of the business plan and make their major decisions. They will not even read through the in-depth booklet of your business plan. It's like an in-depth content. So, but investors, what they see, they just see the executive summary, which we will do in the next, the first point, that is. So when they look at that, they are able to understand how much research you as a business owner has done in the coming pages to understand, you know, what sort of investment you are looking at and what your business goal is. You cannot, if you don't have a business plan, you will not be able to make your pitch deck also properly. If you do not have your business plan in place, you will not know when, at what stage, how much money do you want. So investors can read that very clearly. So it's very important to have a business plan. This business plan will also help you understand what are the risks and challenges you're going to face in your business. So your idea, everything was looking good in the initial stages, but when you start to write this, you will know, okay, these are the challenges. This is where I might need support. This is where I might need help. These are the challenges I might have to overcome. And for that, what should I do? That also you need to document in this business plan. So once you know what the challenge is, you will be able to understand how you will overcome these challenges. So both of this is important. And obviously for further discussion, so that when you're moving to the next level in your business, diversification, maybe amalgamation, maybe adding on businesses, maybe, disinvesting your business, all of these key decisions will, this business plan will be your fallback. So every time you want to go back to it, this business plan, so it's that important a document. And what happens is many of us fail to make this. I'm talking from the point of view of startups and companies where this becomes mandatory. But as even small business owners, in my view, this is a very important booklet that you should prepare in the initial stages, because this becomes your roadmap. This becomes your guiding factor. And generally, we have seen that in small businesses, people fail to, prepare this kind of a roadmap. The more this will only help you bring about a lot of clarity. The more clear you are on what you want from your business, the better it is for you. And this helps you do just that. So far, it's okay, or I'm too fast?
You're okay, Jyoti.
Okay, it's fine.
Okay, Jyoti.
Okay, thanks. Yeah. So, first and foremost, the executive summary, that is the first part of the first page of your business plan. Now, this is a short, crisp summary of everything that is underlying, the operations, the management, the description of your business, market research, everything, one snapshot it is. And that's where the investor will only look into your executive summary and make their decisions. So it's a short summary of what your business is set out to achieve. It basically should answer all your investor questions. And what these questions could be: what sort of a company it is, what are you set out to do, what are the products and services, why is it so special, all these kind of questions which the investor would like to ask is mentioned in your business plan. So it talks about how you're going to, let's look at it one by one. What are your products and services? What is special in your business? Why are you calling it a unique idea? Why are you calling it different from the rest? Who are the managers or the stakeholders? Managers and stakeholders would be not only you, your co-founder, and your leadership team. So all of these, who they are, what is their background, how do I know that, you know, you've got the right kind of people for the right kind of role? So anyone interested in knowing that, this is a snapshot summary which helps them understand. How much money do you need? What's the level of money that you would need at any given stage? You know, initial stage, 3 months, 3 years, 5 years. At each level, how do you plan to, you know, go in with this kind of an investment? Your business idea or product, about your team, a little bit about your team. As I told you, your managers and stakeholders will look at not only who they are, but what sort of background do they carry and whether they are, you know, in the right kind of role and will help you achieve your business goal. Your target audience, which sort of customers, what demographics, what are the details you want to reach out to. Your finances, how have you planned to work on your money for your business. And your vision mission. Vision mission we have done in depth last time. So whenever the vision mission part comes, we'll just go a little faster on that part. Okay. The first and foremost part of your business plan is your description of your business. What do you think should come here? Any thoughts? Basically, this is where you're going to define your business. This is what I'm out to do.
What is your...
Sorry?
Is this a customer-oriented business?
Okay, is this a customer-oriented business? So what exactly is your business set out to do? What are you set out to achieve? Whether you are going in for one idea or multiple ideas. You'll have to write down each one of them. Okay. You need to document your goals basically into short term, long term, and mid term. So what are you going to achieve in this year, in the next 3 years, in the next 5 years, and in the next maybe 100 years? That's lifelong. What is the broad goal of the company? And that comes from your next part, which is the mission statement. So firstly, you will define what are the short-term goals. So within a span of 1 year, what you want to do, where you want to reach, how much market size we do want to capture. Okay, something like that. On those lines, we'll have to set the short-term. Because your first 3 months will go in research and development. The second 3 months will go in market analysis and reaching out to major customers. And in the next 6 months, you will probably understand whether it's a scalable business or not, is it profitable or not. And then you roll out your product or service. And then in the next 6 months, you check the flow of it. And maybe at the end of the year, you feel that it is good. So this is your first step, your short term. So how are you going to do that? What steps will you take to reach out to the entire market? Midterm, what you're going to do in the next 3 years? Okay, one product you've launched. What's the number of scalability? How you're going to increase your market size? First, you will go to other demographies within the country. Then you will move out of the country and so on. What will be your sales number like? So the more clearer we set out these short-term, mid-term and long-term goals, the better it is for our entire team. Because see, as you as a business owner will write this, and when you will give it out into KPIs or executable, actionable plans to your team, they need to understand, and they understand numbers. They are going to be able to understand only, if you tell them, do it in a particular fashion, do it in a particular manner. So all of that detailing comes in here. So defining your business goal is not only, defining the broader picture, but going into the fine detailing. You should be capable of visualizing what your entire journey of business is going to do till you are the owner of the business lifelong. So like you said, life goals, you decide and crystallize it and visualize it every single day, what you're going to do to achieve that goal. Similarly, here you're going to split it into short-term, mid-term and long-term and keep it smart and make yourself clear at each level what you're going to achieve. Your mission statement will help you bring in that focus with a lot of more clarity, because as I said, what are you going to do lifelong with this business is your mission statement. I am here to, we did in the last session, okay, so what was McDonald's mission statement? We look into achieving larger market size, growth, profitability, right? So it, they were very clear on that. Basis that short term, what they're going to do, how many markets they're going to reach out, midterm, how many product types they're going to scale up with, and long term is that, yes, your profitability in terms of numbers will double, triple every year, every quarter, whatever the line of action is. So that's the level of detailing that has to go in describing your business. Make it clear and state everything in numbers, which means that the number of customers that you want to gain. In short term, these many customers I want to gain. Midterm, I want to gain, say, N number of customers. In long term, I want to have so many countries under my head. So that would be the way you will define it in percentages or numbers. What would be the market size you wish to expand? How many markets you want to capture? What is the end goal? Okay. The cost strategy that you're going to adopt. So again, in numbers, what percentage will be your cost in the short term, in the midterm and long term? So short term, maybe your cost will be on the higher side and gradually you will make a profit. You will make your business profitable. So how are you going to measure that cost at every level? What measures of cost reduction you're going to take? Let's say short term, you're saying my cost will be 80%. Midterm, you're achieving 60%. So to achieve from 80 to 60, what steps you're going to do to for cost reduction? Because with your business expansion, with your sales number expansion, you will have to take different measures, no, to reduce the cost. So what would that be? In long term, how are you going to make it a real profitable business? What would be the bottom line that you, at least the minimum bottom line that you would always want to achieve? So that way you should put down in numbers, exact numbers. The next is about your product and services. So in this, again, what all will you write in terms of your product and services? How do you want to research the demand for your business? The first and foremost is you need to research the demand. Whether my product or service is scalable or not, whether people want it or not, and what research you're doing, document it here. This documentation will help you understand, see, because demand keeps changing. Some life was different before lockdown. After lockdown, it is different, right? The demand for technology has expanded. The demand for certain products and goods and services have expanded all of a sudden, have increased all of a sudden. So what? Where do you stand? What is your product and service? Research that in your, under this and write it down. Because today, see, again, when businesses start turning to normalcy, the demands will change. With taste, preferences, changes in lifestyle, we've seen over years, things keep changing very dynamically. So research that demand for your business. Today, you might feel, okay, fine, it's a potential idea. But as I told you in the earlier sessions as well, it's important to have a large scalable business. And to have a large scalable business, that demand should be such that it is ongoing. It will never fall. It will never reduce. It will never come down. So how are you going to sustain? Maybe you may do product diversification. Maybe you may want to do, increase. So at least you can project something. Of course, since change is dynamic, you don't know today what's going to happen tomorrow. But how prepared are you? Have you done that kind of research to have a plan B if this does not work? We'll look at that when we do risk assessment in the subsequent slides. But understand that, just by looking at today's market scenario, you cannot determine that this is a scalable business. Make a proper research for it. Okay, so make sure that if it's a high demand for your goods and services, then you go ahead with a plan. If there is a low demand at any given point of time, maybe 5 years, 10 years down the line, you feel that it's not going to give you long-term demand and it's a failure, stop it there. You need not go further on that. The next part is clearly define your product and services. Don't keep it as vague as it was in your mind when you thought of that unique idea. When I say clearly define means this is my market. These are the number of people I'm going to reach out to. These are the choices that the customers, and put yourself in customer shoes. Will they be able to absorb my goods and services? If I am as a customer for my goods and services, will I find it very interesting and unique? Then it is a great idea. So here you're actually again revisiting your idea, because after writing these 2-3 pages only, you will come to know whether you want to write the entire book or not. So that is the significance of a business plan. So when you're writing this down itself, you will know whether you should go ahead with it or not. And that's why it comes at a very initial stage. So understand the market demand for it, the consumer tastes and preferences, okay, and see whether as a consumer you're able to consume your goods and services or not. And if you feel okay, fine, it's interesting now, and have a very unbiased approach towards your product. Most businesses, what happens, you feel okay, fine, your business is always the best, it is good and it is great because you like it. Okay, but then when you reach out with that product or service to your family member and they immediately say, no, it's not working, it's not good. So make sure you do that at the initial stage. That is very important because that's how you will understand whether it's really scalable or not. Why do you want to invest in something which will lose its charm in the coming few days? So make sure that you are clear on your product and services and how you will define that by understanding and putting yourself in the customer's shoes. Define your USP. Now that you've defined your product and services, you should be capable of saying, okay, this is the unique selling thing that I'm going to target on. This is my product differentiation part. And this is what I can benchmark myself with others. Okay, this is how I'm going to say I am different. This is how I'm going to say this is the additional, maybe an additional service that you're providing, maybe just some extra delivery service or, things like that that you're providing or you want to add on to. Once you're clear on your product and service, only then you will be able to define this USP, because it could be any sort of an add-on, but that add-on should actually make you stand out from the crowd. And that is what USP is all about. So what is your USP? How will you benchmark yourself with others? How are you going to be completely different and unique? So can anyone give me an example? Do you want to take an example at this stage? So let's say we are in the business of, most of you are into training business. So let's take any training product only. Let's talk about soft skills, which is very common today. And many trainers are doing that. And many freelancers are doing that. Many solopreneurs are into that. And every individual is different and every individual has different skill sets to offer. So what is the demand for your business? Is there a high demand for it? Definitely yes, because the education system is not equipping people with this skill. And yes, it is a much needed skill. I would call it the 21st century skill, yes. So demand is there. So that's the reason why there are so many people in the market doing that. Clearly define your product or service. How do you sell yourself or how you sell that skill? Thoughts from you all. We've taken an example of a soft skills trainer or a training company. Because that's something all of us could be, will be able to relate with. So how do you define that product and service uniquely? Market demand, yes, is there. So I move to the next step. Anyone, give it a try. Customer tastes and preferences. It's a skill. It's a much needed skill. It's required. Then why people are not, why we feel that we cannot clearly define it? What are we thinking on? See, because unless we don't do like this, we will not be able to actually define our own business, no? So every trainer or every training company has their own, USP, has their own way of handling this area. Let's say, for example, one company may only deal with providing soft skills training to corporates, like employees in the corporates. Some may do independent programs for schools and colleges. Okay, which is your target audience? How are you going to define your product to reach out to which set of customers? Accordingly, you will design your modules, your sessions, your videos, and your content and everything, right? So customers' tastes and preferences fall in there, right? The people that you're going to reach out to, according to that will be your USP, according to that will be your tagline. So let's say I'm trying to reach out in colleges only. So what would be the main important thing when I'm trying to reach out with a soft skills program for colleges? What could be my USP? So So let's say I have defined my target audience in the short term or long term would be only schools and colleges. So I start with colleges. So help me define my USP now. So one major thing is that at the level of colleges, children are not able to pay that much. So they may not be able to, you have to keep in mind the money aspect of for your course. So I cannot sell on, you know, being a high end course. How do I make it relatable to them? I need to include it in gaming. I can have gaming app for that. I can, you know, teach them soft skills through gaming. Because that is the in thing. That is how students will be able to relate to you. So that can be a USP. Yes or no? I mean, we're just trying to brainstorm with any one particular product or service. Like most of the educational institutes today are doing the same thing in gaming. But you will be doing soft skills in gaming. Yes or no? We can do that or not? How will you benchmark yourself with others? Many are doing it. So what different can I do? So we can do it in this fashion. We can have animated videos if we are reaching out to more of, you know, the smaller children like 10th, 12th, like that. We can come out with animated videos. So that those things will come out to be my USP. And according to that will be my... my vision mission statement, according to that will be my tagline. So all of this becomes important here. You're all with me so far? You're able to relate to the example that I just mentioned?
Yes.
Okay, fine. So I'll just move to the next in that case. Market analysis. Obviously know your market. And how do you know your market? What do you do to know your market? We said we'll do market analysis in my next session. So we are focusing on market analysis this time. So what is it that you will do to, you know, understand your market, understand your competition? So competition is everywhere. Wherever you go, there is going to be competition in any business that you do. So what steps you should do to know your market?
First is we know who are the existing competitors. There we collect their data.
Yeah,
their you know their target audience, their what do you call their niche market, and what are their strength and weakness. Based on that, we can build our own market plan.
Obviously, so you're going to research and understand the growing needs in the market so that you can immediately be one step ahead of them. You're doing all this research of data and people so that you are able to make a better USP of all of this. So you should understand the growing needs, the customers' change and preferences. Yeah. For example, sorry.
So for example, when we meet the major customers of the competitors, we ask them, "Is there anything that you are looking more than what you are getting now?" So they will come out. Yes, I wish such and such. Facilities or features are there, or such and such are. So
yes.
When we come out with our plan, the
competitors
will be
those.
Surprised. How did these people are able to understand what we are and offer better than what? Because that is one thing in market. Being in a marketing profession, I learned that constantly you have to observe your competitors. What is every activities you must constantly, you know, we must have that 80-20 ratio. 80% of the competitors, how they 20% of the competitors, how they are, what are their how they are selling the product, what are the profit range, who are the suppliers, what kind of everything we study, so that we are always one up ahead about all these people.
Absolutely. So there are a lot of companies who do surveys. Okay, so we can approach them and get surveys done with questions like, as you mentioned, what is it that you expect from a session like this, or what is it that you expect from the various things that you have to offer, and let the customer, those survey feedbacks will be the inputs for us to define our USP and understand the customers' tastes and preferences. And yes, as you rightly mentioned, we should know our competitors. What all things of the competitor we should know? Their revenue model. How are they making money? See, what is the main contributor to the profit, the bottom line in their model? We should understand their revenue model. We should understand their business strategy, because unless we don't know their business strategy, we would not be able to understand what is going to be their next move. So unless we have a grip on what business strategy they adopt, we will see. Let's say if a company is totally price centric, or more on the pricing, has a price penetration strategy, that whenever you enter into the new market, slash the prices, enter the market, and then increase your prices. So let's say a company is doing that every single time. So that is their business strategy. Even tomorrow when they enter a new market, they're going to use the same strategy. Are we aware of this? Our strategy should be different. So this is important. So we should study the business strategy of the competitor, study its movements. What is it going to do next? This is very clear, visible on social media, that this is going to be their next move, and a lot of information can be got in from those mechanisms. Today, it's very easy to get these kind of movements. You get information paid as well as not paid, where you can find out what are the movements of your competitors. Do an in-depth market study and analysis. Now, we are doing business plans, so we need to write down all this. Why am I telling you that we need to write down all this in the business plan is because, you are directed in the right manner. You know that this is my competitor, and this is going to be one person that I have to always come one step ahead of. This is my market, and this is my customer's tastes and preferences. This is what they like. And only then I will know now what would be my marketing goals. So all of this documentation is important in the business plan. So obviously the next step is to set clear marketing goals, that is, have a product specific its features. So what is, now that I know what my customer tastes and preferences are, what my competitor is doing, what I am going to offer, what are the features, what are the benefits? This first line, that is product specifics, features and benefits, is the most important thing. Basis this, your advertising team designs advertising. Basis this, your marketing team designs marketing strategies. Basis this only, your entire sales team is going to reach out to the customers in that fashion. Your trading team is going to design sales team trainings basis this alone. Pricing and promotion. What would be the price of your product? Not a range of price. What will be the price of your product, and what promotion you want to do? Which medium of promotion you want to use? How do you want to target your target audience? Let's say my target audience is within the age group of 34 to 45. Where will I get those kind of audience? Obviously, they will not be very active on social media. Some of them may be. But my major audience like this would be on news channels. Between the age group of 35 to 45, if my product has to reach out. So basis that, I will use my promotion strategy where I have to target my target audience. So again, that needs to be clearly documented, which will help your sales team to reach out to them so that they can achieve them in terms of numbers. So again, we'll have numbers and timelines to each of them. Because remember, at the end of the day, you are defining your medium term, short term and long term goals. So your marketing people should know what you want to achieve. What will be the number that you want to achieve today? What is it in terms of number that you want to achieve in the next quarter, next, marketing plans are all quarterly. Then you have monthly reviews and things like that. So all of that should be crisp and clearly defined in terms of numbers for you to make it measurable and reach that goal. Any questions so far?
Fine, they are clear.
No questions, Jyoti.
Yeah, the next is competitive analysis. So you have understood your competition in the market, analysis stage. You've understood who are your key three or four competitors, and you have made a list of what you're going to do and how you're going to beat that competition and make your USP different. Now coming to self introspection, competitive analysis. How am I going to beat the competition? What is my readiness? What do I need to do? You need to write that down as well. And that's why a simple SWOT, So you need to do your business SWOT. Business SWOT separately we'll take up as SWOT, but just I'll touch upon what all needs to come into the plan. So obviously you need to know your strengths and weaknesses. What your strengths are, what now that you know your product, you know your market. So in this, now you know your competitor also, but what is it that different you're going to do becomes your strength here. What are your weaknesses? All your competitor strengths are ideally your weaknesses. So know that, and know that, you know, your customer might leave you just because of your weakness. So how are you going to overcome those weaknesses? That needs to be written down in your business plan. Understand what makes you stand out. Your USP, once USP, will be remaining constant, and you will be shouting out loud with that USP to all your customers every single time. So that should, it should be that strong, and it should be that clear with matching with your product and service. So understand what makes you stand out. It is very important. A lot of thinking goes in writing a business plan, because, and if this is set right, goals are achievable in your business. Your pricing strategy, how you're going to use your price. We'll do pricing strategy as a separate topic also, whether you're going to use market penetration, whether you're going to do customer differentiation, what pricing strategy will you use has to come up in your business SWOT. All right. Define your USP, obviously, because that is a major role of your sales. Check the available resources at your disposal. What money you have? What are the, do you have funding requirements at the initial stage? What is the funding requirement? How much of capital manpower I have? How much manpower I intend to have in the coming 6 months? What is the number of, you know, whether I'm going in for machinery based work or I'm going in for manpower based work? How I'm going to get my raw material? Who are going to be my suppliers? All of this you have to check, because unless you're clear on this, you will not, this is all helps you make your SWOT clear. So you will know that, you know, this is an opportunity available. What is the price at which I can get my raw materials? You will have 2-3 suppliers quotations, which is the best possible. Safety as well, safety measures as well as cost has to be considered here. All of that needs to come. Product cost involved, what will be the my cost per unit of manufacturing that particular product? And then what is profit margin that I'll add to sell it? So what will be my bottom line in that case? Manufacturing capabilities. If I need to establish a plant, how am I going to do it? Where am I going to do it? Whether the government has exemptions on certain states and certain locations where I can utilize that or not. Innovation cycle. Because you will have to, once you write down this first business plan, you will have to keep innovating and adding on to this. How will you keep on innovating on your USP, on your product? How will you keep on adding new things to your basket? How will you keep on making it scalable more and more? What are the innovation steps you will take? How your competitor is doing it? Not only how you are doing it, because you know, you put in money in innovation and you find that, you know, something else is already available in the market of that type. So again, this comes under competitive advantage also. When we do competitive advantage, we will talk about this also. Value addition and at what cost? So it's easy to say that I will today, you know, innovate and, you know, provide more advanced services or enhanced services, enhanced delivery and so on. You're providing a value addition. With this value addition, what is the cost that you're going to incur? Is it still going to lead you to, if not much, the same bottom line? How are you going to do that? That is important. And yes, in compare, this is about yourself and then your customers. Study the trends in the market, the customers' demands, change in preference. How often does your set of customer, your set of target audience, which you decided in the market analysis stage, how often they change their tastes and preferences? Which category, which age group they belong to, what demographics they belong to, do they have sufficient choices? Because everyone is in today's economy, everyone is spoiled for choices. We have a lot of choices. So how many choices are available to your customers and where do you stand over there? Given those multiple choices, would you choose your product or service? If the answer is yes, you're on the right track. If the answer is no, think, innovate right now. Then only go ahead with your business. Now this is the actual execution part. So you need to even write down how your operations and management cycle is. how you are going to define your product, how you are going to deliver it. So far, we only talked about the, you know, the idea, the market analysis, the what I have, what my competitors have, how I am different, how I can benchmark myself differently from the customers. Now everything is okay. So far you've come, you feel that you have a unique idea, you've made it unique, you have set down points as to what you're going to do to make it scalable, and what are the things that you're going to make, what innovations you will add on to it, how you're going to showcase your product. So far you've written that part of the story. Now comes the execution part of it. So you need to also document or write down in your business plan, what are you going, you're defining over here. Now you're actually putting down in black and white as to how you're going to do this, how you're going to manufacture that good, how you're going to deliver that service, what would be the way you would like to use, what mode of operation will you use. So defining the processes and documenting them, this is very important, because you are not going to be everywhere, you are not going to be doing everything. So there will be people, of course, your immediate leadership team, and then in turn, their teams slowly and gradually, which will increase. But at this point of time, have you determined that what would be your method of operation? Whether you will have, you know, what will be your production service delivery process? How will be your chain, your supply chain? How will you reach out? You know, there are certain policies. Every company has policies and procedures. This is the place where you're actually writing down your policies and procedures, that what would be the criteria for selection of a supplier? How will you select your supplier? How will you have your production process in place? What will be the time of operation, mode of operation? What are the safety measures in production of goods and services? How will I deliver these goods and services that I make to the customers? This needs to be documented here. The method of operation, whether I'm using a centralized method or a decentralized method, I have to reach out to many people, but how am I going to reach out? Is it only my sales team which is going to be decentralized and my operations going to be centralized? Or will I have pockets of, you know, operations across different locations? How am I going to work? How am I going to execute my idea? Define the turnaround time. What is my production life cycle? In the first step, when you're defining your production and delivery process, you're actually defining your entire life cycle. So what is that? Have I documented that? What will be the turnaround time for each and every process? How am I going to step by step execute this process? How am I going to say that, okay, if something comes into production, in n number of days it's going to be ready for sale, and it has to sell, what's my shelf life? If there are perishable products and that you have to sell, what will be the shelf life for those products and services? You have to keep it short, so it has to be ongoing and moving. So have I captured that? Have I captured that loss in process? And actually determined so that every time my customer receives the same kind of turnaround time for every single product or service. This mainly you see in banking, right? There's a turnaround time for every single task, and people who achieve what is written in the document, you appreciate that. Other people who do not achieve, it leaves a bad impression on their customers. It's that important. Make it clear, breaking down step by step. That's what I was talking, right from, you know, the thing coming into you, how you're going to process it and how you're going to deliver the finished goods out to your, deliver your services, the pattern in which you're going to deliver your services in that case. So break it down step by step. And this comes with pure documentation. Documentation in terms of SOPs, that is standard operating procedures. This SOPs are not part of business plan, but yes, you need to think through that. You need to have SOPs at the business, at this stage, and you need to write down that, okay, my SOPs again will be revisited when? How often you would like your standard operating procedures to be revisited? How clear and detailed documentation have you done for that? All of that is important at this stage. The next is define management goals. Management goals, this part is very important in terms of execution, the process documentation, and you know, the first part and the second part, that is your management. The first talks about how you're going to do it, and second, the people who are going to work for you, how they are going to, what they are going to do, they should also be a replica of what you do, right? So they should also think like you. Think like you. We talked about vision, mission, and value. The value principles, the code of ethics were things that we said that, okay, if I'm not there everywhere, the same process has to follow comes through the value principles, which is given and imparted in the induction training program. But in the business plan, you need to document what is your vision, mission? How are my team going to achieve it? What are the policies they're going to follow? And this should be really transparent, crisp, clear, not AY. Sorry, one more point is there. Another significant part of defining management goals is what are the ethical standards by which your team has to stand by? So which is a complete no, what is a complete yes for your organization as a whole? So people and your operations, that is how you're going to execute in terms of your systems and processes and how you're going to execute in terms of your people, that is your management goals. This needs to be documented at this stage itself, because otherwise it'll be all just a haywire of activities. So it has to be very crisp, clear, written down and documented so that people know what they are heading for in the organization. Clear so far? We move on to the next.
Yeah, carry on.
Yeah, the next is about the financial components that is basically defining your financial goals. In the initial stage, when we are doing the market strategy and the market analysis, we did think that, you know, we need to reach out to a lot more people, and what would be my revenue stream, what would be my revenue line, how much would, what percentages we would, I would set as sales for my sales team and things like that. Here, in terms of numbers and volume, you're going to put it down in terms of, you know, you can say a projected financial statements. So revenue, how much revenue I'm going to make, what is the value that I'm going to achieve, and the cost associated with. So here I'm having a comparative of, you know, cost and revenue. The tax planning part of it. So in my product or service, do I have tax benefits? Are there any subsidies and exemptions given by the government for this? What is the rate of taxes for my relevant type of company? Do I have certain, SEZs, which are specific economic zones identified for my kind of product or services? All of that comes under the tax planning stage. The financial statements and cash flows, these will be projected right now, because right now you're at the start of the stage. But what projection means, what is your expected business going to look like in 1 year? So what will be your balance sheet? Would you have what sort of assets you would have on your balance sheet? Would you be a more machine intensive industry or more technology intensive industry? All that numbers can come crystal clear in your financial statements. Your cash flows, how are you going to manage your cash flows? How much cash you need at the initial stage, and how the flow of, it's more in-depth analysis of your, how your cash, basically how your profit and loss is moving. The cash flow gives a cash breakup of those items, whether it is revenue or capital, how you're going to expend that in your cash flow. Your debtor cycle and your creditor cycle, what is going to be your debtor cycle? How many, if you're in the distribution business of your products and services, what will be like, generally it's a 30-day cycle in normal businesses, but how long will it take for you to receive money from your debtors and pay off your creditors? Is it matching? Is there a lag? And if there's a lag between the time frame, do you have sufficient cash to fill that gap? This comes out from this financial statements and cash flows. Production process and assets, that is, what are you going to actually do? Are you going to invest capital expenditure into machinery, or are you going to lease out machinery? Are you going to incur more of revenue cost and, pay these lease rentals and, take machinery on rent and do, take place rent on rent and work? Or you want to buy your own space and buy your own machinery? It matters whether it will be a balance sheet item or a expenditure item in profit and loss account. So how are you going to actually analyze this? How you're going to measure your risk? Because yes, every business has a risk. I told you in the earlier stage, we are understanding that your competitor is your biggest risk. Besides that, there are external risks as well, that, we saw the pandemic. What happened with Uttarakhand lately, where there was a landslide, or you can say, the glacier slide. what happens then to your business with these natural calamities? Do you, these are all risks associated with your business. Do you have a plan B for that? Your business should not stop. How will you de-risk your risk? How do you need to do, you need to do a risk assessment for that. You need to understand which is internal, which is external. Do you have a backup plan if your systems don't work, if your machine doesn't, if your machine comes with a breakdown? What is it that you're going to do? Because, you know, remember one thing, your customer is the sole guiding factor for your business. If he or is not satisfied with the product or service, you will lose the customer. So you should have a plan B to make sure that the customer deliverables are always available. The customer, you can be, you should be able to deliver the service, a product or service to your customer every single time. Insure, make sure that you're taking insurances for certain risks. So there is a lot of insurances that are available for you know, your risk. Like you have fire insurance, you have system insurance, you have a lot of insurances. So make sure that you're insured properly so that you have sufficient funds if something happens, if some calamity happens. Then you have investment planning, how you are going to buy these assets. If you say that you're going to buy assets in your production life cycle, how you're going to buy this, whether you're going to diversify. So if you're having a decentralized way of doing business, so are you going to have you know, assets lying all over the place or at one place? How will you make sure that you're having a sufficient amount of liquidity through your cash flows? Your cash flows should not stop during crisis management. How are you going to do that? How you, all this you need to write down in your financial components for your business plan. So just imagine the kind of thinking that can go in while documenting this. Obviously, you can seek support of experts and people around you in your... Yeah, sorry, I think I lost connection. You can view my screen, Nona?
No, Jyoti, I can see only you.
Yeah, now it's okay. Now it's audible.
Screen is not visible. 1 minute. Yeah. So now my screen is visible, right?
Yes.
It's, yeah. Sorry, I think I lost connection. Network is having some issue. So yes, in your investment planning, how you're going to, you know, manage your crisis, how you're going to manage your cash resources during crisis, how you're going to make sure that every single time you're having better returns, how you're going to adopt cost reduction strategies, all of that comes under investment planning. What are, how you're going to, you know, one more aspect here is that the money, the excess money that you have at any given point of time, what sort of investments you're going to put in so that they also generate your revenue for you over and above your main business. And the most important, your exit strategy. Suppose tomorrow, after 5 years, your business doesn't run. What are you going to do? How will you pay off your debts? Do you have sufficient money or a mechanism to pay off your debts? What will be your closing procedures? How are you going to close your operations? You cannot call one day everybody and say that I'm closing my company and do a shutdown. You have to have a process in place. You have to first, you know, make sure, you know, a little more in advance when you have started making the initial losses. And you need to communicate. What communication mechanism will you use to reach out to people and tell them that, you know, this is not available and, you know, this is what you need to do differently. We are closing down. How will you reach out? All of that needs to be documented in your financial, in your financial components as the exit strategy. How will you pay off your investors? Because they will run after you for money. So you need to make sure that first they are cleared. Your employees, how will you discharge? If you are under the PF, everyone will be under the PF Act. So labor laws, how you'll handle? How will you make sure that the PF Act is complied with? What are you going to, all of that calls for money and a strategy to close your company as well. What will be the legal formalities for closure? What will be the cost involved in those legal formalities for closure? All of that will form part of your exit strategy. And yes, last point is obviously the supporting documents. Whatever we've talked so far about market analysis, market research, maybe financial operations, management, financial component, every single thing, have data for that, have backup for that. And that comes in your supporting papers. So your what are these? These are nothing but your research database, your market surveys, technology plans. So if you're having a technology industry, the blueprints and the plans, they will form your working papers, the supporting documents. Your service level agreements with your vendors. What is, because we were talking about turnaround time a while ago. So when you're talking about turnaround time, you need to have a turnaround time for your vendors as well. Otherwise, you'll have a penalty clause in that. So that all comes with your SLA, that's your service level agreements. What are the company policies and plans? That will come your vision, mission, statement, as well as your company projections, plans. All of that will help the operations and management work towards it. Your financial statements and projections, like what is your projected balance sheet and profit and loss, and where do you see 3 years from now? So this is all that you need to take care. It takes time and effort to document all of this down. Initially, when you do this, it's going to be quite a struggle, but make sure you do this much in depth. And simply because at the end of it all, you know that you are guiding yourself in the right direction. Anywhere you feel that it's not workable, change your idea, go back, revisit it, modify it. That's why just writing it down and keeping aside a business plan is not the end of the story, but you also need to make sure that you are revisiting it every single time and, you know, falling back on these. That's why all these supporting papers, documents, everything becomes a part of it. Your investor is only interested in the executive summary. So now you'll understand what actually executive summary is, the last page that you write, but it's placed in front. So now you will know exactly what sort of detailing needs to go, and the investor is just going to have a glimpse of it and know whether your business is scalable or not. So that's about writing a business plan. Any questions so far? Because this is what we have for the business plan. If possible, we can take any of the business plan in this coming week and revisit that. If anyone wants to, we can discuss a business plan in the group during this coming week. So that's next Saturday. We will be talking about SWOT analysis.
Okay.
Yeah. Any questions so far?
It's fine. It's clear.
No, Chetan.
Perfect.
So that's all for today. Thank you for your time. And we look forward for the next session next Saturday. Okay. Next Saturday, we'll be talking about business SWOT, I think. Yeah, business SWOT is what we discuss. We will be discussing more in depth of how to do a business SWOT, like how will you identify your strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats. And then we'll move further. During the week, we will look at if anybody wants to come forward in the group with a business plan, we can revisit that and we can, you know, study that business plan as well. So that will give us everyone insights as to what all we've been talking in theory in terms so far, whether it's actually practically possible for us to go in depth to that extent. Ideally, yes, because I have been writing business plans, so I know that this much is minimal. It requires for a lot more, but this is basic. Itna to hona chahiye.
Okay. Sorry. Good. Jyoti, I have a small request. Yeah. One thing is, if you share some sort of a format, like now for a business plan, like it'd be easy for us to do that sort of format into the business plan. And probably, like, since you're taking a lot of effort, like not time and hard work making this one. So if you like a SWOT analysis, if you show a sample or like, this has to be done. So then it may be useful for me or like other people.
SWOT,
also,
I'll take
like
a case study only. SWOT, I'm not going to tell you exact business plan why I did, because see, every business is different. I tried to do in the beginning with the soft skills part. So in the same manner for every stage we can do, but then it have, you know, anyway, the topic itself is lengthy enough. So I thought it'll go, it'll run too long and we will exceed into dinner time. So that's the reason why I just went with the basics part of it. But yes, I mean, that's what I said, during the week, we can have a discussion in the group on the business plan. If anybody wants to come forward, we can discuss at any one product or service and try to prepare that. And SWOT analysis, yeah, it will be a case study base only. If somebody comes forward with any product or service they want to do a SWOT, we'll take that. Otherwise, we'll take any of the current industry. Maybe I'll try to take into learning and development only, because most of us are in that area. So I'll try to do it in that fashion, or I'll see some other company probably, where we can take up.
Probably.
So yeah, thank you for your time and thanks for listening to me.
We have to thank.